Hello, everybody, and welcome to iHLS Innotech International Conference. In this segment, we'll talk about innovating innovation, how to move ahead, how to stay ahead, especially when it comes to organizations. We have a very distinguished panel here. So, ladies and gentlemen, please introduce yourselves by way of sitting. And it's very nice that we are all in pink. That's very flattering. Let's start with you, Zviya.
Hi, I'm Zviya, Zviya Baron.
Yes.
Zviya Baron, Head of Innovation at IEC, Israel Electric Corporation.
Electric Corporation. Guy Keren, iHLS.
I'm Guy Keren, one of the founders of iHLS, the company that organized this event today.
Thank you very much for having us here, Ran.
Thank you. Ran Natanzon, Head of Innovation and Country Branding in the Israel Ministry of Foreign Affairs.
Thank you. Adi?
Adi Chen Menaker, the Chief of Innovation and Chief Knowledge Officer of IAI.
Tzahi.
Hi. Tzahi or Zach Weisfeld. I run a program called Intel Ignite, which is the startup program of Intel.
Of Intel Corporation here in Israel. Huge operation here in Israel. And Eyal, finally.
Hi, my name is Eyal Miller, and I'm the Vice President and Managing Director for Samsung Next Tel Aviv, which is the local operation for the global Samsung Next.
Great. We'll keep it on a first-name basis with your permission from now on. Thank you very much. Zviya, back to you. Electricity and power companies, you've been with us for ages and ages. How do you bring innovation in?
Well, that's a very good question. I just told somebody here that IEC is 97 years old. So it's one of the oldest corporates here in Israel. And actually, you do it slowly and cautiously. You have to have a strategy. So we first started with a strategy. Actually, it started before I came to IEC. And then we had a vision. Well, actually, we started with a vision. And as Shimon Peres said, if you want to do fantastic things, you have to think, you have to have fantasies, actually. And this is how we do it. IEC is one of Israel's largest corporates, and that means that we have big dreams. And we do it big.
Yeah.
That means that we got the resources, both manpower and women power, and budgets. And we work throughout the corporate. So this is how we do it.
All right. Guy, as she mentioned, transformation of legacy companies and organizations, it's not an easy thing. Take us through the process of this.
Well, I think the biggest problem is that innovation, it's all about the pace. It's all about doing it very, very fast, bringing the technology to the market or to the organization as fast as you can. I'm talking about big organization is adjusting or getting a new system into a large organization will take you about 2 years. Being a startup, you will have about 4 to 5 months to live. So how do you manage of bringing such a fast technology into a slow and big and heavy corporate? And the biggest problem is about the pace. What we found is that COVID-19 actually changed everything. Suddenly, those big companies that keep on shouting, they can't do anything, it's too fast for them, we are not in the pace, suddenly everybody succeeds. Suddenly people start working from home, learning from home, teaching from home.
Because they have no choice.
No choice. And so if you don't have a choice, you are getting into the business because you need to do that. So it's not, I think what happened in the last year, it's not about getting in the technology. It's about the ability of the people that working in those companies actually to understand that they moved the cheese. And the cheese moved. And it's not moved like two paces to the right or to the left. It moves. It absolutely moves. So you need to move with it. And it's possible. We proved that right now.
Yeah.
Absolutely possible. Those companies suddenly having a lot of technology inside, they're getting new people. There was a lot of job changing right now in this year. And I think the world will not going to be the same as it used to be, that's for sure.
Adi, IAI, another huge organization. A lot of work with transformation. How do you do it?
We have been innovative since our creation. Some projects like the ERA program would not have been there if we had not been innovative. And other programs, which we cannot talk about it, is to fulfill the needs of our customers. What we are trying to bring for the last few years is more enabler processes, enabler ways of doing things. During the COVID-19, we did prove that we know how to react very fast to disruptive processes. Within days, we created more than 31 projects, 31 startups, to give results and to give an answer to the needs of the IMOD and the health, the Ministry of Health. And we did provide sanitation of a coronavirus department, sensing of temperature, and we created a line of inhalation machines. So we did prove that I can do it.
Right. So you're a legacy company, obviously, but you do combine startups to the operation. I'm going to ask you, Tzahi, about this, because Intel is a huge one, but you deal with startups.
Yes. So clearly at Intel, we have to innovate. We have lots of competition out there, and we need to keep on innovating. So if you look at innovation, there's inbound innovation, which all the business units are doing to constantly be the best in what they do. And there's out-of-bound innovation. And you can look at out-of-bound innovation, things we're doing through acquisitions. So Mobileye is a good example, and Habana Labs is a good example, and MoveIt is a good example. So clearly taking super interesting new technologies and bring them in. But also the work we do with the outside world through Intel Capital that invests in startups. We also have a team run by another Israeli in Santa Clara, Sagi Ben Moshe, that runs our own internal incubation teams. So it's internal startups inside Intel. So it's a variety of ways that we work with innovation. And my team, which is fairly new to Intel, it's about 18 months old, and it works with startups all over the world. We started in Tel Aviv, now we're going to Munich and Austin. And working with the outside startups, early stage startups, in enhancing their ability to innovate while learning at Intel about that culture.
Culture, component. Exactly. How do you integrate this between, you know, the young guys from the startups and the executives from, you know, the big, huge company?
Yes, so I'll quote one of my former bosses at Microsoft. I used to work many years at Microsoft, and Chi Lu, that used to run the online business and Office, a small $40 billion business, told me once that corporate innovation is dead. It's only going to come from startups and skunkworks. Skunkworks goes back to Lockheed Martin and teams that are basically doing stuff outside of the corporate mentality and processes. So we're trying through Ignite, through the program that I run, to bring that kind of thinking, operating like a startup, fearless mindset, customer obsession, running crazy, not ending every process in 2 years of planning process, but doing it very quick. It's not easy to change cultures of organizations, but it's a big item. Bob, our new, fairly new CEO, last couple of years, Bob Swan, this is the one thing that he put very upfront on his strategy for the company, is changing the culture of Intel. And we're a small tool in that change. And I'm happy we're doing it from here in Israel.
Right. Eyal, I see you agree with this.
I think first of all, similar to my other colleagues here, Samsung has been innovating since establishment. You know, not a lot of people know, but it was established as a grocery store. And it did a long way until it became one of the known tech consumer hardware brand. However, we at Samsung Next believe that the future and the opportunities for Samsung rely in software and services. And we believe that thoughtful integration between software and hardware can yield great potential for Samsung. And this is the goal for our establishment. Our goal is to help transform Samsung to be more software-focused company and realize these opportunities. So we are structured quite uniquely, I believe. On the one front, we have the M&A and the partnership and the investment arm. These guys are looking for acquisition targets, for collaboration opportunities, and also for investments in deep tech startups in order to realize financial gains, but also to collaborate. And very interestingly, we also have our internal product development team, which is about a team of about 100, 150 engineers, product managers, designers, and so forth. So when we're when we see an opportunity, when we see an idea that we believe that can turn into a meaningful product or significant business, and we want to completely own it, we can either build it from scratch or acquire a company and run it. This is kind of like our approach for innovation.
Yeah, interesting. I want to ask you, Ran, about the international angle of this. Obviously, you're from the foreign ministry here of Israel. Every country wants to be an innovator now, right? Countries need to transform also. This is another big issue.
So, yeah, Israel has become a global powerhouse for innovation. And this is due to a few factors. It is it's a government, it's a culture, it's the entrance of the multinationals into Israel. And when we combine these together, we created a special innovation infrastructure. Now we are offering to share this knowledge with the world and try and share our set of mind. It cannot be copied identically to other places in the world, but I think everyone can adapt part of the Israeli innovation.
Export, in other words. And many times change is hard. It's not a simple thing, Zviya. How do you do this? I mean, you have generations of people in the risky company, and suddenly you need startups. You need young blood and young people coming with all these weird ideas.
First of all, well, the blend here is really interesting because IEC are not Samsung or Intel, okay? We are state-owned companies, and that means that the average age is much higher, around 50 in both companies. So it's even harder. So people hate change, as you said. And in electricity, it's an extreme because we are not dealing with innovation. We're dealing with affordable 24/7 supply of electricity, okay? So you have to see the mentality is different. People are not hugging change. Yeah, technology, bring it on. No, that doesn't happen. So what we did, it's like throwing a stone in the water. In every group, in every division, we have an innovation person, either a man or a woman. By the way, there are so many women in innovation, so somebody has to do some research about it. But anyway, and they start working. They identify challenges. They identify the engineers that need the change, that feel the change, that understand that the energy transition is going to blow our minds and our business up. And we work internally with the people. I once had an old professor that said that you can bring the horses to the water, you cannot make them drink. So what we do, we make them addictive to us. We ask for their problems and we bring solutions. We don't choose the solutions. Although sometimes I would like to say, wow, my God, this is what you chose? That's so small, that's so, well, it's not that meaningful. But we are bringing the solutions, we give them the choice to choose. And they can say, no, thank you, not this time. And well, I've been with IEC for the past almost 12 months, and we've started around 40 different pilots and POCs. Now, that might seem small, but that's a huge revolution at the company.
Yeah, I want to ask you, Adi, here about IAI. The electric company is fully government-owned, but you are sort of half and half. It's
on the way.
Somewhere in between. And tell us a little bit about the obstacles you had on the way to innovation in terms of organizational innovation.
In terms of innovation, we have two pillars. We have an organic innovation and we have an open innovation, like you said in different words. Organic innovation is internal innovation. We have established last January our own innovation center, IAI Innovation Center. With the first two cohorts, we had organic innovation. We asked for people within IAI, within the different divisions, you're entitled to come and offer a subject, establish a team like a startup, and we will fund you. We will give you a 13-week program, accelerated, very structured, and we follow you up, we help you, and you have to come with a proof of concept or a minimal viable product, an MVP, and prove it. So far, we are had two cohorts of organic innovation, 10 groups altogether. Each one of the groups got to their goal. They came to the minimum viable product, and it's within ideas from inside the company. Sure. And I'm glad to tell you that for the sum of the projects, we have already customers funding. We have a placed order by customers because they like the idea. They like the solution. They like the ability that we show them that we can do the work. So we continue developing together with them. The third cohort is very unique. It's something that has not been done in any accelerator in the world at the moment up till now. We are doing a hybrid cohort, which is we asked startups to come over and suggest their problem to us. And we provided our best engineers, best technologies to help them solve their problems and improve their technology within this program of 13 weeks. The technology has dual use. The IP that was established will be used by us for use A and by them for use B. And mm-hmm. up till now, as for tomorrow, we have our first design review after 1 month of this cohort, and it's working perfectly.
Interesting. Final word, Ran. Is innovation a commodity that you can really export to other countries?
Oh, this is a tough question. Innovation is not a commodity, but it has a few ways in which you can share Israeli innovation with the whole world. So first thing would be to cooperate with Israeli companies. That would be the first thing. Purchase them or purchase the technology. And the other thing is join the global R&D center of the world in Israel and open your own R&D center if you're a big corporation. Join the group here. That's a really fine group.
So what you're saying is come here. It's here. ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. We could have talked about this for many more minutes, but thank you very much for joining us here. This is this segment of Innotech. We'll see you shortly in the next one.